is prescription for spiritual health. Here it is, going to be 4th of July next week. The health of the country is in trouble. Let's just face it, the health of every country is in trouble in the world today. There's jobs, people don't have jobs. The price of oil is like a yo-yo going up and down. People are shooting everybody. People are getting incarcerated for nothing. If you read the book of Revelations in the last chapters, it's almost like a script for what's going on in the world today. You know, what I'm speaking about, I'm not saying all through ages everyone was saying, well, this is going to be the end. But it's pretty unusual when they talk about the fires and the earthquakes and you turn on the TV and you see Colorado burning. It's almost as if that's a pictorial for the book of Revelations. But as a nurse, I know this. I'm going to share this with you. When you have a patient that sit in a room, you need to make sure yourself that you're okay before you walk in. And then when you walk in, you have to take precautions. Because the patient themselves can get you sick. Now we're talking about spiritual things in this world. Spiritual health. When we face the problems of today and we face the devil of today, you need to make sure that you are healthy before you walk out of there, or that you have your bottle of prescriptions next to you, so when you have that stroke or that problem in the earth, you know, the people that put the thing underneath their tongue? They carry that wherever they go because they might have a pain. Well, let me tell you, it's the word that you need to be carrying. It's that little pill. Now, in John 3, verse 2, it starts off like this. And as you notice, the word likes to start off like this. Dear friend, I pray that you may enjoy good health, that all may go well with you, even as your soul is getting well. In the Bible, it talks about the body is separate than the spiritual. There were people going through persecutions and trials and tribulations that you would think were the worst off, but they were spiritually healthy. Look at the people. The most classic examples when you were a kid, the lion den. Now you'd think he had some problems when he's looking at some lions in there. But God knew he was spiritually healthy and protected him. John expresses his concern for Gallius. This is an elder in the church. He's asking, what is your spiritual health? We as Christians, when we get ready to go outside that door, have to ask, what is our spiritual health? Where do we stand in the sight of God? Because the enemy, whoever it may be, will confront you, whether you like it or not. Bill collectors will be calling. The IRS will be collecting. The cops with the speed, thing, you know, the speed catchers, the radar, they will be out there. There will also be people telling that you're doing the wrong thing, that God doesn't exist. There will be people that see you when you pray, tell you to stop that nonsense. Is our spiritual health ready? Are we healthy enough? I'm not a doctor. I don't plan to play one. In fact, when I was in Africa, I got to be a doctor, and I learned that I don't want to be a doctor because it turned out in the villages they didn't like male nurses. They couldn't comprehend that a man would be a nurse. That was a woman's job. So I was working with this doctor in Ghana, and fortunately I'd worked with him, so I call myself Dr. Wannabe, no MD. That's not an African name. Say it real quick. Dr. Wannabe? And so the patients go, hey, Dr. Wannabe, no MD. And other doctors would laugh because they knew that I was telling them that I wasn't really a doctor, but I was playing the role. Now, if you're spiritually healthy, are you playing the role or are you really a Christian? You can sit there and play the role. You can go to church. Yeah, I'm in church. I can even go to a Bible study and give some money to somebody. But are you playing the role? Or are you a true Christian? They're not one and the same. I can sit in the middle of a garage and call myself a car. It's not going to make myself a car. I can sit there all day and even make car sounds. I'm still not going to be a car. Question is, when you're out there and something goes wrong and you call the name of God, God knows whether you're playing the role or you're really calling His name because of what He can do. What is the need to maintain a good level of spiritual health? Well, as a nurse, I would look at myself and say, hey, you need to lose some weight. That's not good. You're going to kill yourself. I can look at somebody smoking a cigarette and say, well, there's an emphysema patient on the way. Well, as a Christian, we can look at each other. You don't even need a pastor. You don't need someone to tell you whether you're spiritually healthy. How do you depend on God? Do you really depend on God? When you're in a car accident, do you go, oh, God's in charge, I'm driving on? Or do you worry about what man's going to say? Or do you worry about the money that's behind it? Or do you worry at all? There's the test of a faith of a Christian. Are you concerned about what God will do? Or are you concerned about what man will do? You need a strong immune system. You see, we take that's interesting when they talk about immune systems. You see, as a nurse, it distresses me when I see patients take antibiotics all the time. You see, your body can take antibiotics, but they'll build up a resistance. And then they won't work anymore. Well, spiritually, you can do the same thing. You can lie to yourself so much that you'll believe what you say. When I worked in a jail as a nurse, I saw people that really believed they were innocent. And they really were innocent. You know, when you're standing there in a crime scene with a gun, with the smoke coming out, you can't say, I didn't shoot it. But they tell themselves. Are you that kind of Christian that tells yourself that I'm a Christian because I go to church? I'm a Christian because I got a sticker on my car that says Jesus saves. Are you the kind of Christian that goes there and turns on 88.3 on the radio so you lower the window so other people will say, look, there's a Christian. You see, the question is, are you playing the role or are you a Christian? Your health is taking account of that. Then comes the hard part. Again, we'll relate to patients. When you get out of the hospital, you're going to face the same things that you faced before you went in. Are you going to overeat? Are you going to smoke? Are you going to drink? Are you not going to exercise? I had this patient when I first became a nurse. I'll never forget it. First time I ever saw a doctor yell at a patient. I was like, whoa. You see, this man had an ulcer for 10 years. You know that can happen. He never took care of himself. He went to the hospital all the time, had us debride it, that's taking stuff out and cleaning it, and he refused to change his habits. He smoked all the time, which caused circulation to slow down. He drunk all the time. It was messing his body up. And the doctor finally had it and started yelling at them. Now, if it was me at the nurse yelling at the patient, I would have been fired. But the doctor did it. And you know what was interesting what the doctor said? The doctor said to him, you come in here every week expecting the taxpayer to take care of you, and you won't take care of yourself. Now look at this, as us as Christians, every day we expect God to take care of us, but what have we done for Him? Here we do, we go through the day, we make mistakes and things happen to us, and the first thing we say is, God, help us. God, can you do this? Can you solve this problem? But not one time during that whole week before it started did we say, God, and I'm not talking about church time, I'm talking at your house. Just out of the blue, say, God, I love you. God, what can I do for you? It's like my wife told me the other day, or yesterday. She says, I love to hear you say, I love you. But you know what? So does God. God doesn't want you to say, I love you in church. He wants you to say, I love you when you're walking down the street. He wants you to say, I love you when sitting at Burger King and you know you can eat that little Whopper. He wants you to say, God, I love you. God wants to hear you say, I love you when you're in a two-car accident. God wants to hear you say, I love you when you just heard that you have a 25-year life sentence in jail or prison. God wants to hear that. He doesn't want to hear, I love you, when it pleases me to say it. You see, you have to be strong. In order to get spiritually healthy, you have to prepare for it. I've never seen a patient that came to the hospital, to the facility I was at, physically strong without preparing for it. They took care of their body, they exercised, they watched what they ate, they did things. Now, granted, things do happen to you. Just like Christians, things will happen to you. But the question is, are you prepared for when things will happen to you? Regular exercise. You know, again, if you want to be strong, you're supposed to have regular exercise. Not, I walk to the refrigerator 5 times a day. I work at this job and I walk around a lot. That's not regular exercise. I'm sorry. It may feel like regular exercise. You may even put one of those pedometer things on you and say, look, I walk 5 miles today. But you didn't count that you sat down and your metabolism really didn't bounce back and all this. You need regular exercise to get healthy.
Amen.
But you also need regular spiritual exercise. Now, I'll be honest with it. I haven't heard of a spiritual exercise called spiritual Zumba. But there is a form of spiritual Zumba. It's called reading the Bible and doing what it says. And when you go out and do what it says with faith, you're exercising your faith. Now, Zumba is pretty interesting because they're dancing out of mask on, they're going nonstop. Well, that's what a Christian's supposed to do, go nonstop. Doesn't the word say, pray unceasingly? That's sort of like Zumba. They're dancing unceasingly, trying to break out the calories. Well, you're trying to break through to God. And the only way to break through to God is to have the faith that God gave you. And you need to exercise spiritually.
Come on now.
Now, we can work and claim that we're spiritually healthy, but God has our medical chart. But remember, also God said, take a rest. You see, in Mark 6, the apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him that they had done and taught. And then because so many people were coming and going, they didn't even have a chance to eat. And he said to them, come with me yourselves to a quiet place and get rest. When you're exercising, when I was in the Marine Corps, if you ever noticed a Marine, here's how you notice a good new Marine. And you've seen them at the beach. They got a body that is huge from the waist on up. And then from the waist on down, it looks like toothpicks. You've seen them. They're huge. And when they step there, because guess what? They only worked out one part of their body. They gave rest to the other part of the body. And if they get much bigger, they look like they're going to break their legs. You see, that's how we are as Christians sometimes. We're giving the wrong things rest and working out the things that we really shouldn't be. We're supposed to work out stuff, but not all the time. You know, I can read the Bible every day.